Hi, guys. We have somehow made it without freezing to death to Thursday, January 3rd, 2013, here in the frozen wasteland of South Austin, Texas, where we might be looking at some snow coming in shortly. January 3rd, the year is slipping away, and the old Doomsday Prophet is obviously amiss in his duties because I have not come forward with my own Doomsday Prophet environmental alarmist chronicler of the downfall of civilization prediction rant from my rock, and we're already to the third day of the year. So I've been wrestling around this and figuring out how I was going to handle this. I was listening last night to the Alex Jones channel, where Alex, to his credit, I guess probably has learned from the past not to do these doomsday predictions. So he handed off the job to his fellow Mike Adams, who I'm losing respect for more and more. Mike Adams, the health ranger, he used to deal with natural foods and stuff, but now he's become an Alex Kool-Aid drinker. So he had his 20 predictions all about, they're coming for our guns, they're coming for our guns, and the martial law that's going to be declared in the country, and these false flag terrorists, fake terrorist things that are going to be going on. There's going to be bombs blowing everywhere. It's going to be martial law. They're coming for our guns. They're coming for our silver, you know, blah, 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 Mike. So at first, this rant was going to be an antidote to his, but I'm not going to waste any more my breath on the right-wing fear-mongering of the Alex Jones Kool-Aid drinkers. So I was going back to figuring out what I was going to say when I turned on my computer this morning, and my good friend Pookaloo from out there in California saved my ass this morning and made my job very easy, because he sent me the blog. I think it's called the Arch Druid Report, a blog by a fellow I've mentioned here several times on Humpty Dumpty Tribe named John Michael Greer. Greer's not in my, he hasn't quite made my heroes list, but he certainly deserves honorable mention from here on the rock. And I'll put a link. This is a very long, involved, very well-written blog entry, and I will put a link to it here. I encourage you to read the thing. I'm gonna pick, you know, parts of it out to share with you. So anyway, what he does is he makes his predictions for 2013. And as I was reading this thing, John Michael Greer's predictions for 2013, I noticed that it was almost verbatim, practically verbatim, word for word, coming exactly what I, you know, had been wrestling around in my own head. So to keep me from babbling on with my, you know, and nose picking and everything else, I'll just read you what John Michael Greer, his call, because I agree with this 100%, not 99.9%. John Michael Greer, he and I are psychically connected, and his blog article this week is called Into an Unknown Country, and as I say, I'll have the link, and I really advise you to spend about the 10 or 15 minutes of your life reading this. He takes a while to get down to his prediction. So I'm going to jump way down. First he looks back at his 2012 predictions, and he did pretty good. He did pretty good for the simple reason that he was very general in his predictions, and the couple of times he tried to be specific, he missed it. So this is a lesson to doomsday prophets. This is the most likely way that a doomsday prophet has to trip himself up and to make himself look like a fool, is to make very detailed predictions, particularly when you put a timeline on them. You need to call what is going to happen and when it's going to happen. And when these don't pan out, you look like an idiot. I have plenty of other ways of looking like an idiot without having to go down this road, which is why I'm not even making my own predictions. I'm putting it off on John Michael Greer. So next year, if what he says here and I agree with doesn't come true, I can say, I never said that. John Michael Greer, that pagan druid, that crazy-ass bearded pagan druid made these calls for 2013. But right now, I will... So anyway, it's been a long time... Okay. All right. I'd like to... Okay, and this finally he gets out of 2012 into this year. I'd like to put on my sorcerer's cap and gaze a little deeper into the mists of futurity. Okay, I thus predict, and here's and I echo every word that he's getting ready to say here. I thus predict that just as 2012 looked like a remake of 2011, a little further down the curve of decline, 2013 will look a good deal like 2012, but with further worsening along the same broad array of trends, and yet another round of local crises and regional disasters. The number of billion-dollar weather disasters will tick up further, as will the number of Americans who have no job. Though, to be sure, the official unemployment rate and other economic statistics will be gimmicked then as now. The U.S. dollar, the euro, and the world's stock markets will still be in business at year's end, and there will still be gas for sale in gas stations, groceries for sale in grocery stores, and more people interested in the Super Bowl than in global warming or peak oil as 2013 gives way to 2014. There you go. I could not have said it better myself, John Michael Greer, which is why I chose you to say it for me. You called it exactly right. Exactly right. And this is the safe way to be a doomsday prophet, is to call general themes over a fuzzy timeline. And the theme for the past 200 years, particularly the past 50 years, is particularly from a planetary, ecological, environmental perspective. Based on a human lifetime, it looks like a slow crumbling decline. What it looks like from a geological perspective is an absolute crash. All right, from on the geological record will present what appears to us as a slow crumbling decline, which might take three or four generations to destroy all life on this planet, including our own. It's going to be a tiny little millimeter in the geologic record. You know, when these irradiated cockroaches and future space aliens are measuring and trying to figure out what the hell happened here in this little bitty blip. And that is what we are seeing unfolding in our own lifetimes here, as we go into another year of steady disintegration. Okay, and then he goes from there, and then he does get a little more specific, and the more specific he gets, the more I distance myself. Like here he's calling for, he's encouraging his readers to watch the fracking bubble. The fracking bubble. Now, he says that he doesn't think the fracking bubble is going to burst in 2013. He's actually looking ahead to 2014. He sees all the signs of a bubble in the fracking industry. I'm assuming he's talking about gas and oil here. Now, I don't necessarily agree with him. We will see if he's right, that the fracking bubble, every bit of evidence I see is that these goddamn frackers, they ain't gonna stop till there's nothing left. It's a race between the frackers and Mother Earth. Are we all going to be fried into crispy critters before these planet-eating sons of bitches pull their drill bits out? Okay, now, yeah, so then he goes from fracking, you know, speaking, and he goes back into global warming. Guys, I'm freezing my ass on this rock, as I said yesterday. There is no global warming. It's clearly a myth. It's getting ready to snow. So anyway, I'd also encourage my readers to watch the climate. The tendency to focus on predicted apocalypses to come while ignoring the reality of ongoing collapse in the present is as evident here as in every other corner of contemporary culture. Whether or not this planet gets fried to a crackly crunch by some more or less distant future date, it is irrefutable that the cost of weather-related disasters across the world has been climbing year over year for decades, and this is placing an increasingly harsh burden on local and regional economies here in the U.S. and elsewhere. There you go. You know, once again, this is not going to be any... Guys, it ain't coming down as much as I wish it was in a lot of ways this year. It ain't coming down, but it's coming down the line. I've got an audience here for my daily rant, but I'm gonna. He can. So Donnie, you can sit here and listen to me finish this, or if you want. I'm not sure Donnie knows what I do for a living. Okay, and all right. Okay, then finally, the whole last part of this long, well-written article is that in turn leads to the question of what my readers might do about it all. Okay, and this is what I do for a living, is put myself up here on this rock as some sort of pathetic example of what at least one dumb hippie on a rock in South Austin, Texas, is doing about it all. And once again, it sounds like I'm dovetailing perfectly well with this crazy pagan druid out there wherever he lives. Okay. My advice has not changed. It is a source of some amusement to me, though, that no matter how clearly I try to communicate that advice, a fair number of people will hear what they want to hear, or perhaps what they expect to hear, rather than what I am saying. Okay. What I'm saying, this is John Greer talking, but you know, as I'm saying that, you know, this guy is speaking right out of my own head. It's like the son of a bitch is up there in my skull. All right. What I am saying is that any meaningful response to the crisis of our times has got to begin on the individual level with changes in our own lives. This man who's listening to me is a paragon of this. Hallelujah, Donnie. I could have him sitting up here with me on this rock. He is, even though he probably hasn't even heard of what I'm doing, that here's a man right in front of me who I think understands this. Better than most of my buddies, I'll give him that. Okay.
If you want it, you have to live it.
There you go. If you want it, you have to live it. There. That's, I can put that whole round. All right. Back to Greer here. To say that it should begin there does not mean that it should end there. What it does mean is that without the foundation of personal change, neither activism nor community nor anything else is going to do much. There you go. If none of the members of a community are willing to make the changes necessary to decrease their own dependence on this failing industrial system, just what good is the community as a whole supposed to do? Okay, then we go, and you know what I was talking about from this rock just yesterday. A great many people like to insist that changing your own life is not enough. And then they act as though that means that changing your own life isn't necessary. Again, not so. If industrial society as a whole has to stop dumping excess carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, dear reader, that means, among many other things, that you personally have to stop contributing your share. Equally, if industrial society as a whole is running short of fossil fuels, that means, among many other things, that you personally are going to have to get used to living without them. My friend Donnie drove up here on his bicycle. You know, he and I will be going to a picking party later tonight, freezing our asses on our bicycles. Oh, boy. There you go. If none of the members of a community are willing to make the changes necessary to decrease their own dependence on a failing industrial system, just what good is community as a whole supposed to do? I'm repeating that. That it all begins here. It doesn't end here, but it begins here. And you are the only person, the handful of people on this planet, you know, who are responsible for this. Okay, that being the case, why not start the new year? Why not start with the part of the problem about which you personally can actually do something? Your own consumption of fossil fuels, and then go from there. Thank you. Okay, this guy, I say he's after my own heart. Political activism, community building, and a great many other proposed responses to the crisis of our time are entirely valid and workable approaches if those who pursue them start the process by making the changes in their own personal lives they expect other people to make, in turn, lacking that foundation, they go nowhere. Jesus, it's not even worth arguing anymore about what happens when people try to get other people to do things they won't do for themselves. You know, what the hell do I keep climbing up on this rock about? We've had decades of that. It hasn't helped, and it's high time that the obvious lessons get drawn from that fact. Okay, this is why, I love picking on my number one hero, Derek Jensen, talking about bringing down industrial civilization. But before he talks about it, he's got to get that Alaskan crab leg from the all-you-can-eat Chinese buffet out of his mouth so he can talk to us about bringing down industrial fishing. And then he can't get on his keyboard and start writing until he pulls that gas-sucking car of his over to the side of the road so he can free up his hands. Derek, you're as guilty as this as the rest of us, buddy. I love you, buddy, and I'm cheering you on. But, with all your Gandhi bashing, Gandhi had a few things to say that maybe you need to listen to. That John Greer is repeating. So here we go.
If you can't be an example for your cause, you shouldn't say anything about it.
There you go. Here's one of my examples right here. All right. That being said, okay, I was going to break this into a separate rant, but it's all part of it. I'm just going to keep it running. That being said, here are some suggested New Year's resolutions for those of my readers who have any interest in being part of the solution. Now, of course, yesterday I was up on this rock with my New Year's resolution that I am done with eating seafood. I'm done with it. Okay? The guilt and the conscience and the complete immorality of the seafood industry, I'm done with it, guys. So that's nowhere, something that outrageous is nowhere on this list, but this is a place to start. And of course, number one, here we go. This is the one that I have not done. Caulk, weather strip, and insulate the place where you live. Well, I live in a factory produced aluminum trailer with all of this built-in seals and caulking and weather stripping. So I'm guilty. I did not do this one. Okay. Number two, make at least one commute or run at least one errand per week on foot, by bicycle, or public transit. Guys, I went to the grocery store on a mule last week. And every time I go to the grocery store, I walk down this dried up creek bed to Fiesta. I've been doing it for 4 years. I'm a 53-year-old white man. Look at me. I know I look like a damn hippie, but I don't look that bad. And my guess is I'm probably healthier than you are. And this planet is a healthier planet for me making this decision by making virtually 100% of my errands per week on foot, bicycle, public transit, or mule. Okay, number three, I am guilty as charged. If you take a vacation, take the train. Now, you may remember my rants from last summer. This is what I attempted to do. My friend and I, we were going to take a round the country road trip. We decided to do it by rail, but the Amtrak system in this country is so completely outlandish and difficult to do. We just had to scrap it, and I guiltily must report, as I did, that I took a road trip in a gas-sucking car. So this is my whine about the Amtrak system. I'm not even going to get off on the rant. Okay, but I'm guilty as charged. I did not take the train. And I'm going to take the responsibility for it and not put it on Amtrak. I could have done it. Okay? Number four, buy it used. No shit, Sherlock. This applies to everything from cars, should you actually need a car in your life, to the cheapest trinkets. Well, don't buy the goddamn car or the cheap trinkets. In the year 2012, what have I bought new? Well, I did a report that I did go buy my little $25 made in China heater from Lowe's and this camera that's filming this. I did buy new. Those I believe, I mean, guys, obviously what I eat, is somewhat new. So not counting what I put in my mouth, whether I'm eating it, drinking it, or hopefully smoking it, what I can think of is this camera and that heater I did buy new in a 365-day year. It's hardly like I even bought it used. I mean, everything you see here came from the clothing. My booties, $1. This pair of pants, maybe $1. This thing was given to me. This jacket might have been $2. I sprung $15 on the used hat. Okay, buy it used. All right, number five, turn off the boob tube. Better still, if you can talk the people you live with into it, get rid of the damn thing altogether. Enough said on that. I got rid of my damn boob tube in 1998. Okay. Take up an art, craft, or hobby. How about organic gardening and playing acoustic music with your friends? This is what I do. Of course, my garden, I'll have to do a rant. My garden is not looking good, guys. That's a separate rant. You can judge for yourself how good my harmonica playing is. Okay, number seven. And this is his last one. I thought this will be the last one, and I will wrap up this rant with this. Number seven, do without something this year. This is the scary one for most people in today's consumer society, to be able to have something, but to choose not to have it. To choose not to have it challenges some of the deepest of modern taboos. Huh? Okay, give it a try, guys.
Cigarettes.
yeah, cigarettes, right? I have never smoked a cigarette since the day I was born. Never in my entire life. So, as I've mentioned from this rock, guys, I could get up right now, today. I could get up today, and I've got, I think, $63,000 buried in the ground. I could get up today. By tomorrow, I could own a gas-sucking car. I could own a house. I could be living in I could put a sizable down payment on a decent little house. I could have of course it would be a used house. I could go out, buy a damn nice used car. I could go out and buy a damn nice used stereo, used boob tube. I could fill up my new used house with all of this shit that I threw out of my life 4 years ago. I could do that. I choose not to do it. This is a choice. I'm choosing to live in a 20-foot trailer with no plumbing. I am choosing to shit in a bucket of sawdust. Okay? These are the choices I have made, and it's the reason I get up here. And this is the final point that he makes, where I admit I don't know if I'm guilty of this or not. Okay, give it a try. The point is not to strike an assumed pose of ecological virtue, by the way, so don't tell anybody what you're doing without, or even that you're doing without something. Now this, guys, this is where I am torn. I have read this thing before, and I've mentioned it. If you're out there doing something, and you're keeping it hidden from, you know, from people. What's the point? You know, first you need to find your own truth with a capital T, and then you need to get up on your rock and preach it. This is what I have been doing for 2.5 years. But I have mentioned, and Donnie, here's a man right here. Have you ever, did you know what I've been doing for the past 2.5 years? Do you know that I've been getting up on this damn rock every day and doing this?
Something of this order, yeah, a little bit.
Something. Have you ever in your entire life tuned in to Humpty Dumpty Tribe and watched one of these rants in your life?
No, I don't have. But see, those are all the things. Those are part of the things that I've cheated myself out of too. You see that?
There you go.
You know.
See, this man doesn't need to be listening to Humpty Dumpty Tribe. But the vast majority of my friends, I mean, I'm talking about here in real life, have no clue what I'm doing. They've never heard of Humpty Dumpty. They have zero clue what I'm doing, or if they've heard some snickering behind my back rumors, is that old ham bones up there talking about December 21st, 2012, or some asteroid or something, some crap like this. I don't. In my own teeny weeny little personal life here in South Austin, I just keep my mouth shut on those unbelievably about once every 6 months. When people bring up the conversation and ask me my opinion, which virtually never, you know, I will start to say it. I usually get about 90 seconds into it before the eyes roll back in their head and they stick a joint in my mouth and a bottle of beer and tell me to shut the hell up and stick a harp back in harmonica back in my mouth. But up here on this rock, this is what I'm doing. For anybody who wants to listen to me and John Michael Greer and Derek Jensen and all these other guys whose work that I share with you, I will be bringing it to you here from this rock as we head into 2013, and I will be chronicling the continuing downfall of this civilization. Bring it on, the sooner the better. But for now, I'm going to wrap up this rant. I'll come back at you with a couple of real short ones in a minute, but I'm going to go see, talk to my buddy Donnie for a minute. As I say, come up here and introduce yourself, Donnie, just for a minute. I just, because I want people to understand that there's two of us. Here you go.
In this world.
Here you go. This is one of my Humpty Dumpty Tribe heroes right here. Whenever I'm talking about my clueless friends, I'm not talking about this man. He's on that bicycle. He lives in what, a 20-foot school bus, which used to be parked on the exact spot that my trailer is on. I have taken over his former school bus spot. And so here you go. There's two of us. All right. It's a movement. There's two of us.
If 50,000 people in each state would march on their government seat, which is their capital, in 50 states, that's 2.5 million people. That's a formidable army. If people walk down to their government.
Walk down to their government. Don't take your gas-sucking car to a protest against tar sands.
And on this, on the first round, guns won't be necessary either. But, you know, the American people need to step up and make a serious statement to their government and the world around them that they are still Americans, and these are just the characteristics of the things that they do as Americans. Let's not be so complacent to look at the world around us and wonder what can we do. The resolution to all of this is in our actions, not in our thoughts. So we need to think about what's been done in the past, because as they say, the one thing that we've learned from history is that we never learn from history. So let's do the things that we know from history were definitive and had a true objective to them that established, well, for instance, this country, this very rock we're sitting on here today, the fact that we are still free to do that.
Yeah, I don't know for how much longer. Anyway, yeah. I could see this man could start his own channel, and I wish he would. But anyway, I better wrap this up because probably five or six people on this planet who are still with us. Anyway, this is Donnie. I'm going to get him back up on this rock at some point on a warmer day. Bye for now, guys.
yeah, I could get started too. I'm glad I didn't.